Meanwhile, state seismologists record over 100 aftershocks in various quake-hit areas.
Over 900 more cases of highly transmissible Omicron subvariants detected in the Philippines.
And the U.S. reports the biggest one-day increase of monkeypox cases.
Good afternoon, I'm Ron Crew.
And I'm Denise Dinsai. You're watching Top Story.
Hindi pa tayo makikit dun!
The Philippine province of Abra placed under a state of calamity a day after a powerful quake rocked the province and other parts of Luzon. Several establishments in Abra, the epicenter of the tremor, were damaged. Power and water interruptions also reported. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. visited Abra, where he presided over a situation briefing. According to the latest tally, at least 5 people have been killed in the tremor, while over 20,000 individuals were affected. Marcos instructed government officials to prioritize restoring power, water, and communication lines in all quake-hit areas.
Unfortunately, yung pag-inspeksyon ng linya will take time, but I think we will just have to do as much as we can, as quickly as possible. Of course, that's going to be for the key for our relief efforts, lahat ng gagawin natin. We have to be able to communicate and we have to be able to operate. So we need, that's why inuna ko yung dalawang yun, to find out what our capabilities are. I'm particularly interested dun sa that simple purification system because we don't know how long it's going to take. We should procure more of those because immediately water is always going to be a problem. Para hindi, you know, things like cholera, diphtheria will come into play.
A mayor in Abra wants President Marcos to help boost the disaster response capability of local governments. La Paz Abra Mayor Joseph Bernos urges the president to heed their call for additional fire trucks and ambulances. Marcos, for his part, says he will look into the issues Bernos raised.
Yung makikita lang po, may fire truck sila na panahon pa po ng tatay ninyo na fire truck yun. Yun, that was 30
something. So, inihiling ko po na sana palakasin yung disaster response ng mga LGUs. This time, siguro naman po, open na po lahat yung request namin because may Ilocano president na kami and we delivered 96% of the votes of Abra during the last election. So tingin ko, kami naman po maniningil ngayon.
Fear still grips quake-hit victims as they continue to experience aftershocks. The Philippine Institute of Volcanology and Seismology has recorded over 800 aftershocks since Wednesday morning's magnitude 7 tremor. More are expected in the coming days and even weeks. Despite the risks, some residents chose to stay at home.
Kung meron sira yung bahay, may ngayon minor crack lang yan, pero kung maya't maya, aalugin mo yung bahay. So, magdi-deteriorate, kumbaga. Siguro yung maliit na crack ngayon, after 2 days, 3 days, baka malaking crack na, which could lead na sa pag-collapse ng bahay.
Okay, kaya, payo po ninyo.
Huwag mo nang i-re-occupy yun. So, until such time na, let's say, na check na ng mga municipal engineer or kung sino mang responsible officials na knowledgeable how to assess ang structural integrity po ng bahay.
In Ilocos Norte, a number of homes and buildings were damaged following the strong quake. Governor Matthew Manotoc says most of those damaged were schools and historical buildings. But he stresses the damage was only minor. For Manotoc, Wednesday's major earthquake is a wake-up call for government officials to be more prepared for disasters.
it's a reminder no na kailangan talagang on alert ang mga first responders no and ang mga basic supplies and necessities na kailangan ng tao and siguro high time na rin na i-check ang structural integrity ng mga buildings po natin especially ang mga historical buildings na alam po natin medyo more at risk.
Let's now check the latest situation in quake-hit areas. We now have Rosemary Pablo Lindawan of Ifugao's Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Council. Good afternoon, ma'am. Thank you for joining us.
Yes, good afternoon, po.
Ms. Lindawan, how are the rescue efforts? How's the clearing of the roads? How is the situation compared to yesterday?
As of today, at least the road network in Banawi is passable, and in Aguinaldo, all roads are also passable except for some sections. For the other roads, like that in Bahagnamal and Liwanamal in Atipulo, are not passable to any kind of vehicle because of landslides due to the earthquake. So in Kiangan, the municipality of Kiangan, one lane is passable at most of the sitios because of landslides also.
The roads, ma'am, that you just mentioned that are not passable, has DPWH reached out? What are the steps being taken to fix these?
Yes, actually po. There are already equipment sent to repair or rehab some of the roads and some of the equipment also of the provincial local government unit of Ifugao are working on those roads which were eroded.
How about the inspection of the structural integrity of some buildings or infrastructure in the area? How is it?
As of today, a composite team of the members of the PDRRMC and the PDRRMO, including those of the personnel from the Provincial Engineering Office and the YES, are on constant monitoring and they are assessing most of the buildings in the facilities of the Provincial Local Government Unit of Ifugao.
So far, how about the hospitals and medical facilities? Have the patients or those staying there been evacuated? When can they go back or when can it be used again?
So far at the present, there are no evacuations considering that the hospitals are structurally safe for occupancy. So far, what were revealed were cracks. And yun lang po. Actually, safe po for occupancy yung mga hospitals natin dito sa Ifugao.
Kamusta naman ho mga aftershocks doon? May nararamdaman pa po ba dyan?
Yes po. Actually, kanina lang may aftershock but it was a bit short and light compared to the main earthquake yesterday. So as compared to yesterday, this is already slight, so there was no need for us to be comparing to the evacuation ground. And anyway, most of the buildings and facilities here were declared as structurally safe, except for some slight cracks on walls and the flooring.
So, ma'am, what's being done, I guess, of course, as precaution, since aftershocks are still happening, and they have mentioned na baka ho tuloy-tuloy lang ho yan in the coming days and even in the coming weeks.
Yes po. Actually, the alternate operation center is still activated and we are still on blue alert. So we have already staff and personnel there who are monitoring and on 24/7 duty. So that any, and we are monitoring reports, we are getting reports from the different municipalities and the different agencies for any emergencies, and the staff and personnel are ready to be deployed.
Do we have an estimate cost of damage to infrastructure?
as for the cost, for the cost of damage, we have an estimated cost for damage infrastructure. We have 5,462,000 pesos.
And how about for any casualties, whether death, fatalities, or even injuries, ma'am?
For the casualties, actually, we have three from the municipality of Tinoc, but they were already given first aid and psychological intervention. So more or less, it is already taken care of by our personnel.
Ms. Rosemary Pablo Lindawan of Ifugao's Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Council. Ms. Lindawan, thank you so much, and I hope you continue to stay safe.
Yeah, thank you also.
We have more news. Three people were injured by the quake in Baguio City. Among them, a student who fell from the second floor of her dorm as she was trying to use the fire exit. Mayor Benjamin Magalong says she's conscious and under constant monitoring at the hospital. Meanwhile, there have been no reports of major structural damage. Magalong says classes in all levels and work have resumed after roads were cleared of debris.
The two other main roads leading to the city of Baguio from the south, and I'm referring to Naguilian and Marcos Highway, they're now open. Yesterday, only one lane of Marcos Highway was open, but it was already cleared last night. So two lanes of Marcos Highway are already passable. In fact, we're already accepting tourists.
Philippine authorities reopened more quake-hit roads in the Cordillera Administrative Region. The Public Works Department declared these three roads passable to traffic. So far, 17 out of 21 road sections affected by Wednesday's tremor have now been reopened. Public Works Secretary Manuel Bonoan says President Marcos has ordered his agency to work double time to reopen the remaining closed roads. The Philippine Social Welfare Department gives its assurance the necessary assistance are being given to earthquake victims. These include psychosocial counseling. A DSWD official adds they are making sure children, pregnant women, and breastfeeding mothers are given safe spaces in evacuation centers. The DSWD earlier released 10 million pesos to help survivors, under which victims can receive 5 to 10,000 pesos on top of burial assistance. The agency notes it has more standby funds should they be needed.
Kinonsolidate na namin yung mga pera na available, yung mga funds na available, non-food items and food items na available, ready po. Nasa higit 1 billion piso po, yung naka-standby po dito po sa DSWD. Handa nating iayuda sa ating mga kababayan.
Over 8,000 schools were affected by Wednesday's quake in Luzon. 61 were damaged. That's based on the initial assessment of the Philippine Disaster Management Agency. The Education Department has called for an emergency meeting with the regional and division disaster officials of the affected regions so they can coordinate their response. It's also looking into the number of affected students, teachers, and non-teaching personnel. Let's now talk to the Office of Civil Defense's Officer in Charge, Rafael Alejandro, for more updates about quake-hit areas. Good afternoon, sir. Thank you so much for joining us.
Yes, good afternoon, Dines. Magandang hapon sa ating lahat.
Sir, any updates that you can give that happened during the local briefing? What topics or, I guess, what is being prioritized right now by the President?
Opo, the priority right now is really to restore yung power. Yung road network na dapat ma-clear na, and then yung water, power, and communication, yan yung top three priority niya. And of course yung housing, no, dapat ma-assess na. We should be able to assess it, and if declared livable ay dapat makabalik na yung ating mga kababayan, no. So yan po ang kanyang marching orders. we should be able to restore power, communication, the road network, including water, no? Para magbalik sa normal yung ating mga residente doon.
ASEC, what's the timeline for this, for the water? We saw, of course, in the press briefing of President Marcos, a lot of diseases could storm from the lack of clean water that's being provided in these areas. So, kailan po maayos? Also, with the road fixing, also checking the houses, what's the timeline?
Yeah. There's no specific timeline na bigay, no? Kasi maraming gagawin dito. But for the road, ang instruction niya was ASAP, dapat within the day, or at least by tomorrow, lahat na major roads should be passable na, which ginagawa naman ng ating DPWH. And yung water, medyo complicated lang because these are delegated to the water utilities, no, local utilities. The DPWH was asked by the president or was directed to assist local government units and its water facilities to fast track yung mga areas na apektado yung kanilang water supply. So DPWH will be doing that. And for the meantime, we'll try to, ang guidance niya was to provide the filtration machines, no, water filtration machines or units na pwedeng dalhin doon. In fact, si DILG Secretary and MMDA ay magpapadala na ng kanilang water filtration units sa mga hard-hit areas na walang tubig para magkaroon sila ng immediate water supply. So mga stopgap measures muna, including ang OCD will be sending some bottled waters as stopgap measures. But of course, we are asking DPWH to expedite yung assistance natin sa lahat ng mga LGUs na nangangailangan nito. And there are a number of LGUs na talagang kailangan maasistahan para mabalik po yung kanilang normal water supply.
ASEC, do you have a general estimate of the total number, the estimated cost in infrastructure damage? In Ilocos region, it's 38.8 billion. A while ago, we were talking to the Ifugao PDRMO, and they said it's estimated at 5 million. How about for the totality? Do we have the numbers for that?
Right now, no, as of 5 o'clock, we still have a figure of 38.8 million. And we are expecting na tataas ito. This will increase as we receive additional reports on damages, no? Mm-hmm. Naging complicated lang ito because there are some structures na cultural heritage structures na iba ang valuation. So yes, hindi natin basta-basta, we cannot just put value in it, the damage, the value, no, on the damage, kasi it needs validation from our National Historical Institute. So, but we are expecting this figure to increase as we receive reports from the ground.
Now, do we have enough funds for all of those fixing? Not even to mention, of course, the fixing of some tourism sites, heritage sites that we still haven't gotten the valuation for. Do we have enough funds?
Yeah, for now, no, the available NDRIM fund or the National Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Fund is still around 12 billion, no? We can tap that, and there are other sources naman that DBM can pull. So we can manage pa naman. Funds are sufficient to provide the immediate requirements that are needed on the ground.
Office of Civil Defense Officer in Charge, ASEC Rafi Alejandro. ASEC, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you very much.
The Philippine Red Cross sends rescue teams to quick-hit areas. PRC Chairman Richard Gordon says they have also deployed ambulances and heavy equipment.
Every time there is a need for it, we will send it. Because ang idea namin is talaga may hub and spoke kami na magamit, as usually the chapters would have their own ambulances, meron tayong mga water tankers, at may payloader tayo, yeah, na pag kami nag-iba, pangakatulog pa nga yan eh, dahil nung araw pag na, alibaw sa Catanduanes, gumamit kami ng payloader dyan, nagdala kami, pinadaan pa sa dagat.
Those in need of help may also call the Philippine Red Cross Emergency Hotline 143.
The National Telecommunications Commission orders telco companies to provide free call and charging services in quake-hit areas. The order is valid until August 5th. In response, PLDT Smart deployed teams to set up free call stations in Abra and Ilocos Sur. Globe Telecom also installed a station offering free calls, charging, and Wi-Fi in Abra. The company's telehealth service, Consulta MD, is also offering residents free consultations with a general physician for a month. Globe subscribers, meanwhile, can help quake victims by converting their data into reward points, which in turn can be sent to charities and foundations.
The Government Service Insurance System, or GSIS, ready to provide emergency loans to members affected by the earthquake. The GSIS says the state pension fund has allocated 5.4 billion pesos for the emergency loan program this year. Active members and pensioners can avail of a 20,000 peso loan once a state of calamity is declared in their areas of residence or work.
If you were able to avail of an emergency loan, ang emergency loan po natin ay 3 years to pay. For example po, last year, nag-avail po kayo. Pag hindi pa po kayo fully paid, pwede pa rin po kayo mag-avail. Kung ganun po ang sitwasyon, ang inyong loanable amount po is 40,000 pesos. Bakit po 40,000? Para po maisarado yung old loan and the net proceeds will still be going to the member.
Home Development Fund Pag-ibig also preparing emergency loans for quake-hit members.
Makakautang po kayo ng up to 80% ng inyong inimpok sa Pag-ibig Fund. So on average, this is around 18,000 pesos po per member on average. No? Tapos pwede po kayo mag-avail up to 90 days from a declaration of state of calamity. Huwag na muna kayo mag-file ng multi-purpose loan. Okay? Mag-file kayo ng calamity loan. And ipuput lang namin on hold muna, okay? Habang inaantay natin yung declaration of state of calamity. Tapos as soon as pumasok yung declaration of state of calamity, ipaprocess na po namin ang inyong calamity loan.
Up next, over 900 more Omicron subvariant cases detected in the Philippines.
And the U.S. reports over 1,000 new monkeypox infections. More news when we return.
Welcome back. The Philippine government says talks are underway to craft a code of conduct in the South China Sea aimed at easing tensions in the highly disputed area. The Department of Foreign Affairs says stakeholders are working on the general provisions while there has been progress on agreeing to the objectives. Assistant Secretary Daniel Espiritu says there's still no decision yet on whether the code of conduct will be legally binding. Espiritu, however, notes the Philippines wants Manila's arbitral win part of the COC.
The Hague ruling is based on UNCLOS, and definitely UNCLOS will be a basis of the COC. Let me stress this. We are asserting the Hague ruling. But whatever is it that's on the Hague ruling are only reflections of specific provisions in UNCLOS. So whether we invoke the arbitral tribunal award or not, the point is, the moment we use UNCLOS in the COC, in the negotiations of the COC, and its resultant mechanisms, I guess that will already be enough. In fact, UNCLOS is bigger than the arbitral award.
China is claiming almost all of the resource-rich region, but several countries, including the Philippines, have overlapping claims.
The Philippines detects over 900 more cases of highly transmissible Omicron subvariants. The BA.5 again makes up the majority of the additional infections at 890. The health department says that subvariant was found in all regions except Bangsamoro and Soccsaryen. Meanwhile, the country also logged 18 more BA.4 cases and 15 infections of the BA 2.12.1. The Philippines recorded over 21,000 new COVID cases in the previous week, about a 30% increase from the week before.
The alleged inaction of the Health Technology Assessment Council, or HTAC, to blame for the expiration of over 5.1 billion pesos worth of COVID-19 vaccines purchased by the private sector. That's according to former presidential advisor for entrepreneurship, Joey Concepcion. He says the losses could have been prevented if only authorities acted fast on repeated requests to expand the second booster coverage. Concepcion says they've been calling for that as early as March.
I would have thought that the DOH leadership could have stepped in, no, and really tried to intervene. What changed the mind of HTAC today? I don't know. Maybe a lot of pressure coming from us. Mm-hmm. Maybe finally they saw the vaccines are going to expire. But the DOH secretary should be able to overrule any of these committees. These are supposed to be advisory committees anyway.
Concepcion also doubling down on his call to start the process for vaccine makers to apply for a certificate of product registration. That would make COVID vaccines commercially available, allowing the public to purchase shots easily.
The Pasay City General Hospital seeing an increase of non-COVID admissions. ABS-CBN correspondent Michael Delizo joins us on the line for details. Michael?
Hi, Denise. The Pasay City General Hospital, or PCGH, has reached full capacity due to the surge of non-COVID cases. In an interview with ABS-CBN News, PCGH officer in charge, Jan Victor de Gracia, said the hospital's medical and surgery clean wards, medical and pediatric transition wards, and emergency room beds are already full since Wednesday.
Dahil sa dagsa po sila, no? Dagsaan po ngayon ng mga kaso ng mga stroke, ng mga inaatake sa puso, yung mga dengue sa mga bata po natin, kaya napupuno na po yung mga transition wards natin. Yung mga surgical cases namin ngayon, dumadami na rin. Ganun din ang aming OB wards, so marami nang nanganganak.
He added that the waiting list for ER admission has surpassed more than 20 patients and they can no longer accommodate additional patients. He advised other sick individuals to be brought or transferred to other healthcare facilities for proper and immediate healthcare management. In a press briefing on Thursday, Health Undersecretary Beverly Lorraine Ho said the national utilization rate for non-COVID beds is already at 72%, which is considered high risk.
Because we have started parang regular operations already again of our hospitals, then hindi lang po yung COVID cases, no, yung naggagamit ng hospital beds, but more importantly, there are other diseases.
Among other diseases that the DOH is monitoring is dengue. The number of dengue cases has already reached 73,909 since July 9th, a 96% increase compared to the reported 37,000 cases during the same period last year. Back to you, Denise.
Thanks, Michael.
Senator Sunny Angara, in step with President Marcos's goal to build specialty hospitals like the Philippine Heart Center in geographically isolated regions and provinces in the country. That's one of Angara's priority bills this 19th Congress. He hopes the existing medical scholarship law will help in supplying the needed manpower for these health facilities.
I think what's often cited is we don't have enough specialist doctors to man some of these. If we build these hospitals, where do we get the doctors? Not just doctors, but also trained nurses, trained barangay health workers all over the country. They're barangay health workers, but many of them are need to be upskilled. No? So there's really a need for an overarching and a comprehensive study of our health system, whether it's personnel, the dispersal of the competitiveness of their compensation.
Angara, who chairs the Senate Finance Committee, estimates it will cost around 10 to 15 billion pesos a year to build additional health facilities.
Traditionally, there's a health facilities enhancement program fund It's called the HFEP. And there's usually 10 to 20 billion pesos there. So it's really a matter of having very focused spending. We can be creative about how we fund our healthcare system. No, because there's the national government. Many people are just looking at the national government to shoulder these costs. But you also have the local governments. There's a new development in local government finance, which is the Mandanas doctrine or the Mandanas decision, which gives more resources to the health personnel. You also have PPP. So there's also the private sector.
The U.S. reports over 1,000 new monkeypox cases. That's the biggest one-day increase on record. In total, the U.S. has recorded 4,600 monkeypox cases. And globally, there are now over 20,000 cases in 71 countries. Because of this, Australia has declared monkeypox a communicable disease incident of national significance. Australia has so far detected 44 cases, majority of which are returning travelers. The World Health Organization now calling on countries to take the risks seriously and take the necessary steps to stop transmission.
The best way to do that is to reduce the risk of exposure. That means making safe choices for yourself and others. For men who have sex with men, this includes, for the moment, reducing your number of sexual partners, reconsidering sex with new partners, and exchanging contact details with any new partners to enable follow-up if needed.
Back here at home, Malacanang extends the authority of officers in charge in government agencies until the end of the year. OICs are only supposed to serve until July 31st or until a replacement has been appointed. Malacanang says a new order will ensure the continuous and effective delivery of government services, even in agencies where Marcos has yet to appoint any secretary. So far, the president has yet to appoint those who would head the departments of health, science and technology, and housing and urban development.
The election of several lawmakers to keep posts at the House of Representatives not sitting well with some of their colleagues. RG Cruz gives us the latest on the reorganization at the upper and lower chambers of Congress.
Albay 1st District Representative Edsel Lagman and New House Minority Leader Marcelino Libana did not mince words against each other after Lagman flagged Libana's election as a minority leader, who he claimed was handpicked by the majority.
Mr. Speaker, distinguished colleagues, let me start by expressing my disappointment and disenchantment in the new House leaderships and the new administrations perpetuating the practice of anointing the majority's minority leader. This is an open secret, a brutal fact.
In this August chamber, we are required to observe proper decorum. We are required to observe proper parliamentary language and proper parliamentary courtesy, Mr. Speaker. We have to go to our constitution. Mr. Speaker, for a veteran legislator to stand there and give some insinuations to the members of minority, if not put into proper place, will not be good for our chamber.
Lagman cites the badges of interference, such as when Libanan thanked the majority after his election, taking his oath before the speaker, and Libanan asking for the plenary's approval when he picked the minority's representatives to the House committees. Libanan no longer responded to Lagman. Kabataan Party List Representative Raul Manuel meanwhile flagged the election of presidential son Ilocos Norte 1st District Representative Sandro Marcos as senior deputy majority leader. But Representative Margarita Nograles fired back, insisting on Marcos's qualification for the job, citing his knowledge and experience from understudying at the majority leader's office when his uncle, the current speaker, had that post. Albay Representative Joey Salceda says being the son of the president makes Representative Marcos an asset to the House and its members.
hindi mo na kailangan duman sa KES. So hindi mo na kailangan i-filter pa yung messaging. So kung anong problema sa house, makakarap na agad kay Presidente. So mas mapapabilis po ang legislative meal.
Former Senator, now Batangas Representative Ralph Recto, Pampanga Representative Aurelio Don Gonzalez, and Cebu Representative Duke Frasco were elected to become the 7th, 8th, and 9th Deputy Speaker of the House. The Speaker's wife, Tingog Party List Representative Yeda Romualdez, would be in charge of the House's institutional purse as Chair of the House Committee on Accounts, while a key ally of the Speaker, Acobico Representative Zaldi Co, would be in charge of the national budget as Chair of the House Committee on Appropriations. Other chairmen of key House committees have been named as well. At the Senate, Senator Francis Tolentino now heads the powerful Blue Ribbon Committee. Senator Sonny Angara, the Finance Committee, and Senator Sherwin Gatchalian, the Ways and Means Committee. Two committees, Foreign Relations and Social Justice, Welfare and Rural Development, went to the President's sister, Senator Amy Marcos. RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine transport regulators saying they are leaning towards granting a fare hike petition of bus operators. ABS-CBN correspondent Jackie Manaba joins us on the line for details. Jackie?
Ron, the Land Transportation Franchising Regulatory Board, or LTFRB, is open to granting the petition of bus operators for a fare increase. But the LTFRB is still studying the fare adjustment since it wants to address the interests of both bus operators and commuters. LTFRB Chairperson Chelly Garfield said the board will ask the National Economic and Development Authority, or NEDA, for recommendations. Since October 2018, city bus operators have been charging 11 pesos for the first 5 kilometers and 1 peso and 85 centavos for every succeeding kilometer for ordinary buses. For air-conditioned buses, minimum fare is at 13 pesos and 2 pesos and 20 centavos for every succeeding kilometer. They want this raised by at least 4 to 15 pesos and 2 pesos and 70 centavos for every succeeding kilometer for ordinary buses. They also want the minimum fare of aircon buses to be raised by 7 pesos to 20 pesos, while every succeeding kilometer should be 3 pesos and 40 centavos. Provincial buses are also asking for an increase from the current minimum fare of 9 pesos and every succeeding kilometer of 1 peso and 55 centavos for ordinary buses to 15 pesos as minimum fare and 2 pesos for every succeeding kilometer. For air-conditioned provincial buses, they want to raise fares to 2 pesos and 50 centavos per kilometer for regular, 2 pesos and 60 centavos per kilometer for deluxe, 2 pesos and 70 centavos per kilometer for super deluxe, and 3 pesos and 60 centavos per kilometer for luxury. Commuter groups are also open to fare increase, but they have their reservations. Garafil did not mention a specific date for the release of a resolution to the petition, but she said that this could be released before the resumption of face-to-face classes. She said the board is cognizant of operators' concerns that they cannot deploy all of their units due to high price of fuel. With fewer buses on the road, commuters are struggling to get a ride, especially during rush hours. Back to you, Ron.
Jackie Manabat with that report. Thank you very much.
The PSE Index becomes the best performer in Asia on Thursday as investors react to the latest rate hike from the U.S. Federal Reserve. Michelle Ong reports.
Asian markets made cautious gains on Thursday after the Federal Reserve jacked up rates again by 75 basis points, as expected, and vowed no surrender in fighting inflation.
I do not think the U.S. is currently in a recession. And the reason is there are just too many areas of the economy that are performing, too well. And of course, I would point to the labor market in particular. While another unusually large increase could be appropriate at our next meeting, that is a decision that will depend on the data we get between now and then.
Investors found some relief that the Fed isn't any more hawkish today. First Metro Securities' Royce Aguilar says now is the time to be picky.
The day after
the market normalizes, the market pulls back in line with what we know in school, in the concept that an aggressive monetary policy is not good for equities. Bear case right now, let's say, for the end of the end year of the PSCI, we're looking at 6,600 as bear case. So, okay, if you see a limited, if we see a limited upside for the PSCI, this is the time to remain picky. You should have cash right now. This is not the time to be fully aggressive.
For the day, the PSE index jumped 2.3% to close back above 6,300, with advancers beating decliners almost 3-1. BDO Capital's Ed Francisco admits the Philippine market is, in a way, still held hostage by negative developments abroad. Citing risks and volatility, he tells investors to also look at investing in fixed income or parking their money for now.
If it were just Philippines per se, I think we've seen the worst. No, we have had good elections. The SONA, I think the economic platform was pretty good. So no surprise, pleasant surprises there. The only reason lang I will be a little hesitant of saying we've seen the worst is only because it's more external. If something happens in the U.S. or because the U.S. is going to be strengthening, right? Although there's this fears of recession. So if it strengthens further, and that's really the safe haven. Relative to the U.S., we might weaken, and therefore there might be that hit.
In corporate stories, China Bank posts a 39% growth in the first half of the year at $10.1 billion, thanks to higher net interest income and lower provisions. These were enough to offset weaker trading and forex gains. The bank, which has yet to release the second quarter breakdown, says its net income already breached the 5 billion peso mark, a first in its over 100-year-old franchise. Still in the earnings stream, aircon and refrigerator company Concepcion Industrial posts flat earnings for the second quarter of the year at 233 million pesos as higher commodity prices, logistics costs, and a weaker peso were partially offset by price adjustments and cost-cutting measures. The firm, however, notes good recovery in the commercial segment, which saw new orders as well as fulfilled backlog orders as the economy further opened up. Consumer markets, though, remained soft in the usually strong summer seasons in the past. Meanwhile, home improvement and construction supplies retailer Wilcon Depot enjoyed a 56% jump in second quarter profit to a little over 1 billion pesos, bringing first half earnings to 1.9 billion. The company says higher volume of business and gross profit margins helped offset rising operating expenses. Two new stores were added in the second quarter, bringing the total network to 76 stores. The company says it's on track to meet their expansion target of 8 new depots this year, with 4 more set to go live by the second half. It expects net sales to grow by at least high teens for 2022. In other news, ABS-CBN President and CEO Carlo Katigbak tells shareholders a return to profitability is possible in the near term based on the current trajectory of the company's financial performance. Key will be managing costs and exploring new revenue streams, including partnerships.
The commercial partnerships we have signed with companies like Zoe and TV5 have resulted in an improvement in our ratings. From a low of 1.1% after our shutdown, we have achieved a 4.1% rating, with primetime growing from 2.1% to 9.6%.
ABS-CBN is a parent of this news channel. And finally, Megaworld launches its third residential project in capital town Pampanga, the 15-story Montrose Parkview, which is expected to generate $2.8 billion in sales. The project is located beside the Capitol Mall and upcoming BPO office towers. It's expected to be completed by 2027. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
The Bureau of Internal Revenue warns consumers prices of digital services may increase. That's after President Marcos announced his administration's plans to impose tax on digital services. More from Alvin El Chico.
Angelica has her own YouTube channel, subscriptions to Netflix and Spotify, as well as various online shopping apps. As a digital savvy person, Angelica was not surprised when President Marcos announced government's plan to impose value-added tax on foreign-owned online platforms.
Our tax system will be adjusted in order to catch up with the rapid developments of the digital economy, including the imposition of value-added tax on digital service providers.
Since
talamak naman ngayon na going na tayo sa digital, it's bound to happen. Parang naisip ko na one of these days, ito na nga, tataksan na rin yung mga ganyan.
But the BIR clarifies, current online transactions are already covered by existing tax laws, as buying and selling online is just similar to transactions done with physical stores.
Kung at the end of the year, wala naman po kayong kinita o yung kita ninyo is maliit or mababa sa 250,000, eh wala pong buwis. Pero sa value-added tax po, this is business taxation, eh base po siya sa gross sales or receipts. Again, hindi yung kita, hindi yung neto. Gross sales or receipts. Pag more than 3 million ka in a year, eh mandatory po, subject ka sa value-added tax.
The BIR says government's target is to run after digital platforms not registered in the Philippines but earn big bucks from Filipino subscribers. The BIR admits though, the imposition of VAT may push charges up.
Ang tina-target natin is yung nakakawala sa radar ng Pilipinas because they are non-residents. Now on that aspeto, yes, it might be possible that some of the services of this non-resident may have slightly to adjust in their pricing.
For some experts, strictly imposing taxes on online transactions will make goods and services more expensive.
Tatamaan talaga niyang consumer. Kaya nga sinasabi natin, pwede ba pag-isipan niyo muna? Kasi ang Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development or OECD, OECD. Matagal nang pinag-aaralan yan na dahil nga ito ay mga nakabase naman karamihan dito sa US, dapat magkaroon ng share ang mga estado kung saan nag-ooperate at kumikita itong mga tech giants na to ng kanilang income. Pero kapag pinatawag mula ng 12% VAT, tayo na nga tatamaan yan.
I think that's something that has to be a very internal process between our government and the owners of these tech companies wherein they have to come to a point or either a middle ground wherein not just us as consumers, kasi definitely you guys as well, not just yung mga normal na mamamayan, but even government workers and people in position use social media. So definitely they have a say on this as well. Kasi alam nila na sila din ay matatamaan.
But for Alfie, it's okay to impose taxes on online transactions as well as subscriptions as long as government is able to explain where the money goes.
Bakit ba kailangan? Ineffective ba yun dati? Saan napupunta yun dati at bakit kailangan mo maglabas ng bago?
In his sauna, Marcos said government will get nearly 12 billion pesos in additional revenue on the first year of charging VAT on digital platforms. Alvin Ochico, ABS-CBN News.
The Financial Executives Institute of the Philippines calls on more businesses to engage in stakeholder capitalism. Warren De Guzman reports.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. called on the corporate sector for help in many areas of development in his first sauna on Monday. The Financial Executives Institute of the Philippines gathered Wednesday to discuss stakeholder capitalism at the 6th Ayala Finex Summit. The basic thrust is to get more Filipino CEOs and CFOs to make a conscious effort toward including the best interests of all stakeholders, from owners and shareholders to customers and employees to government and communities, in all of their business decisions and directives. J.J. Moreno, president of AF Payments and author of the Philippine Stock Exchange's Corporate Governance Guidelines, has been fighting for stakeholder capitalism for decades. His AF Payments company runs the beep card for commuters, and he strives to make sure his customer base's daily experience is as bearable as possible through transparency and accountability. Moreno says he just wishes more companies do the same.
Let me make it clear, there are organizations that are genuinely committed to this. My impatience comes from the fact that there are not too many of them yet. My recommendation is we get them together. And really, if you may mentor these big organizations, mentor small organizations.
John Canto of McKinsey & Company says even though there is empirical data to show this approach is actually profitable in the long run, many executives do not take it, especially if it hurts their quarterly or short-term profits. Canto says progress in this kind of capitalism has to stem from open dialogue, and stakeholders do not necessarily have to be confrontational to get things done.
It's a learning process. As a country, we are not as far in the journey as some of the others are. So we don't necessarily understand. I mean, we have expectations, of course, but what is realistic within a certain time frame, how companies are changing, how stockholders should behave, how to engage our suppliers, again, our industry groups, the media, things are in flux, right? And I don't be overly optimistic to say things will change in a very quick manner, but when.
Finex President Michael Gorin believes change is already happening, with many CEOs and CFOs already making public stands on issues like sustainability. He encourages members of his organization to follow in their footsteps. Moreno says, now is the time.
This is the time that we actually have to surrender ourselves to the cause, be it stakeholder capitalism, governance, ethics. There is a higher... We have to surrender ourselves to us Filipinos, being good CFOs, being good CEOs, doing the right thing. This is a revolution in my view, and we have a country to fight for.
The discussion on stakeholder capitalism comes amid an increased participation by the private sector on many fronts, including the fight against COVID-19. Warren De Guzman, ABS-CBN News.
We're taking a short break. Stay with us. Welcome back. A lawyer and triathlete from the Philippines, Cody Pinoy Aquaman, makes another feat as he completed a 5-kilometer open water swim in Lake Michigan in the U.S. Connie Makatula De Leon tells us more in this report.
46-year-old triathlete Ingemar Macarine has done it again. The Bohol-based Macarine completed a full open water swim in Lake Michigan last Sunday, an event organized by iSwim for veterans. Despite Lake Michigan's reputation as one of the world's most dangerous lakes, this Pinoy Aquaman completed the swim in 2 hours and 57 minutes, covering a distance of more than 3 miles.
Yung waves lang talaga kanina, medyo malalaki talaga. Although, I encountered big waves before, pero kanina, salubong eh. Kaya, medyo mahirap. We have to shorten it by half. So instead of 10 kilometers, we have to shorten it by 5 kilometers because of bad weather.
Macarine, who is a public prosecutor by profession, says that his open swim journey that started a decade ago came from his desire to make a difference in himself and in the community.
I'm promoting marine conservation in the Philippines and also healthy lifestyle. Zero alcohol for 5 years already, and I'm a vegetarian. And of course, I sleep 8 hours a day. And I exercise every day.
As an endurance swimmer, Macarine has completed 36 open water swim events, including swimming from the Alcatraz Island to San Francisco, swimming across Chesapeake Bay in Maryland, Hudson River in New York, Lake Lane in Florida, and Golden Gate Bridge in California. Phil Amrey Letada, the organizer of the event and founder of iSwim for Veterans, says his goal is to help families, especially those who have lost loved ones.
We've lost quite a few of our men during the combat operations. So in the process, there were family members that were really hard up financially. So I thought about creating an organization, something like this. And
Macarina says people should not be discouraged by setbacks, but rather let their experiences be their guiding light as they push for success.
My dream is to really swim the English Channel. I have already tried twice, but I failed. Those failures motivates me to swim again, probably 2 or 3 years from now.
As he flies back to the Philippines, Macarina says he will continue to train for more open water swims in Leyte and in Masbate. Connie Makatula De Leon, ABS-CBN News, Chicago.
And those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Tensai.
And I'm Ron Cruz. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thank you for watching.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.